So let's now have a look at a bit more complicated example. We have here a CSV file containing weather information. We have here the date given as the first entry, then the station ID. So imagine there are stations around the country and they have a unique ID. Here we have the hour of the day and finally the temperature. And we want to do some analysis over this. So this file, the CSV file, is laying in the distributed file system and we want to find out some information about it. So let's say we want to have, first of all, only the information from the year 2014. This is like the example of grep we have seen before. So we do not need a reducer, we only need the map phase. So this means that in the end, when we do this, we have different files in our file system and they only contain here the, as you can see, the information from the year 2014. There's one file per mapper. There's no partitioning done by key. There's no sorting done, right? So it's a very simple analysis. And now we want to add the reducer that is doing something useful. So let's say we're interested in the average temperature for every hour of the day in 2014. If this makes scientifically sense, if you're like an environmental researcher, then I don't know, but let's do that. So we have now the file as before, and we have already seen how we can filter that we get only the 2014 tuples from our CSV file. And we want to have now an average. Average means we have to group, as you know from database systems, we have to group according to the key and then compute the aggregate, so the average in this case. And this is exactly the task of the reducer. So we want to have the average temperature for each hour of the day, right? And this already tells you what the key has to be, because the key has to be in this case, obviously, the hour of the day in order to have the tuples ending at the same reducer so we can aggregate them. So let's say we have two reducers. So two machines or tasks running it in different machines. We configure the system accordingly. This corresponds, or this means that we have to create two partitions. So the tuples are partitioned based on the key into one or the other partition. And a default way how partitioning is working, if you're considering Java notation, is that you're taking the key, in this case, hour of the day, you're taking some hash code out of this, and then you're taking the modulo operation regarding the number of partitions, in this case, two. And then according to the output here, you assign these tuples to one or the other partition, and this is like what you're sending to the machines, to the two reducer machines. Yeah. And this means, it should be clear by this already definition, but let's emphasize again on that, you have of course 24 different hours of the day and you have only two partitions. So of course now it means that you have one reducer obtaining or getting multiple different hour of the day information. But it's fully fine. I made this already clear kind of in the example from the beginning. We talked about Hello World and also the term databases, which would land at the same reducer. This is fine, and it has to be like this. Imagine you have like 100,000 different terms. You don't need 100,000 different machines, right? So you have two machines now, and more hours of the day, so there will be of course multiple hours of the day falling into the same partition. But this is fine. The only thing we have to take care of in the implementation of our MapReduce infrastructure, well, we don't have to, we just download it and use it, right? But of course it means not that in the reduce function call we are mixing up different hours of the day. So it should be clear. So the reducer obtains these partitions, but then what I just said, it's important that there will be one reduce function call per hour of the day. So we are not mixing up different hours of the day. And then the output is overall, we have two reducers. And then the output could be looking like this. One file per reducer. This is the first file, the other file. And inside the file, these lines are sorted by hour of day, as we can see. So 14, 17, 23. It is example here. And here we have 4, 16, and 22. Of course, we have also the average temperature values. And important, and we will also come to see about this later on in the lecture, it's important to note that the sorting is not done globally. It's always done within a file. But as you can see here, you could not just append these files and would have a final file with a global order. So this does not work. But within the output of a reducer, the information is sorted based on the key. In this case, hour of the day. So this is what I mentioned already. There can be in general, there will be in general several keys in a partition, but however, don't worry. Then if you're looking at the reduce function call, then everything will be fine. You're doing it only per like a single key. And also what is written in red here, if you have form partitions, it will never happen that you have the hour of the day 5 going at some point to this partition and at some point to this partition. This cannot happen. If this would happen, then the MapReduce result would be wrong, as you can illustrate in the WordCount example, because the hello, let's say, term would end up at different reducer machines, hence in different reduce calls, and then you would not have a global information about the number of occurrences for this term. So this is like important to reflect when you're talking about it, when you're trying to understand this partitioning, right? Yeah, sorting is done based on the key, and data, of course, is grouped by the key, as we have seen multiple times. And you always have to carefully think what is the key you want to group by, so that the reduce gets all required information. And of course, also, you have to see what is the reduce function then finally doing, so in terms of specifying code. We have seen in the example of the first filtering for 2014 entries and also in the grab example that you can have MapReduce jobs where there is no reducer. These are called map-only jobs. Here, no sorting takes place. The emit result will be just written to disk. You can, however, have an identity reducer that is not doing anything but just outputs the data it receives, but here sorting will take place. So this is like the small difference between a map-only job and an identity reducer. You can combine multiple MapReduce jobs together. This is forming then a so-called DAG, directed acyclic graph. And this means that the MapReduce job is consuming the outputs of other MapReduce jobs that were running before. The results of MapReduce are always written back to the distributed file system. And hence, you can then consume it for forthcoming jobs. In this lecture here, we will look only at single MapReduce jobs, not how you can combine them together. With the exception, I have to say, when we look at graph problems, we would do some iterative processing. Okay, now get a bit more concrete about how does the code look like that you have to provide. Of course, you have to do a little bit more than these pseudocodes I have written. Here is some sample, some part of the code in the WordCount example that would run in Hadoop in some earlier version. There's also a link on the next slide where I took it from the tutorial. And this might look like, it's Java. I guess you have seen that already. And now let's see what's hidden here. There's of course like some notation around some specificness of Hadoop and some class names you don't know, like long writable and so on. And exception handling. But forget that for a moment, just look, or forget that in total, for at least for this slide here. When you're implementing this, of course, you have to get this right, but then you look at the tutorial again and the full code. So what I want to show you is basically these few lines. So again, it's word count. What do we do in word count? We iterate over the input string. Look, this is done by the tokenizer, the string tokenizer in Java. You're running over all of these tokens by using the hasMoreTokens function of the string tokenizer. And then you're writing the word as the key, the first parameter, and the value 1 to the network, to the intermediate results, where it will be shuffled to the reducer. Now this one is simply like one defined object which corresponds to the count 1. Just like again, a little bit dupe specific. And also the context is an object that you can use to write. We have just called it earlier simply emit. In Hadoop, this is called a write to the context. But doesn't matter. Here, what you see is basically the same thing. Like a pair of key value, the word, and the count 1. That is what we have seen already earlier. Like we emitted ring, and the 1 is the count. So now, if you're a data scientist working in a large company and they have set up Hadoop MapReduce in the data center, in the cluster, and you want to compute the word count in order to make some analysis over word usages, then you basically have to implement, there's a little bit more around, but not much more, few lines of code, and everything else will be handled by the MapReduce implementation. You don't have to care about like replication or failing nodes and so on. You just let it run, and depending on how big the data is, it might take some minutes or even hours, and then you come back and you find in the distributed file system the results, right? So this is like the reason why Hadoop or like MapReduce is so successful, or was at least, because you can write a few lines of code and don't bother with any network issue or distributed implementations of your algorithms. You just implement this in this framework, and then you submit the jar file containing the code to this master node, and this will take care of the computation. How does the reduce look like? So here we have the reduce function. We initialize sum with 0, and then we iterate over all entries of our value, which is here an iterable, over or like on int values. And we're summing up all of these, and in the end, again, writing it, we called that emit earlier, the key, which is here the text, which is the term, and the sum to our context, which means Hadoop will then take care that this is written to the distributed file system. So if you're looking at this, forget all these extras around for now, but if you're looking at the code, the application logic, the real code that you have to write, this is pretty much like the pseudocode we have seen earlier, right? It's not pretty more complicated except for some specific notations of Hadoop, right? But this is like what you have to provide in order to run word count over really large amounts of data, and don't have to care about anything about fault tolerance and so on. In some cases, and probably you have already seen that, or we talked very briefly about it in the beginning, having this Lord of the Ring example, if you're emitting in the mapper, let's say for a term ring, 1 and a 1 and a 1, why don't you just emit 3, right? This you can implement by modifying the map function. But this can also be done using an additional concept that is called a combiner. The observation is that the map phase can emit quite large amounts of data, and you could reduce that already locally before sending over the network, because network bandwidth is often the limiting factor. So when can you do this? It does not work for all functions, but if you're looking at, for instance, in this example, you want to compute the maximum number, then it doesn't matter if you sending to the reducer all of these single values, or you already have locally at the mapper an execution of the max function on 1, 2, 6 or 2, 1, 9, because the max over all of the values is the same as the max over the max values. So then the reducer would still work if you're looking for the maximum. However, here you have to send 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 values over the network, and here only 1 and 2, right? Because you have 2 max values here. And typically, not always, the code you're using for a combiner is the same code that you use for the reducer. However, this is not always possible. And it's also important to notice that this is not the replacement of the reducer. It's only a way to limit the amount of data you have to send over the network. Why is this not a replacement of the reducer? Well, the combiner is attached to the map task, and the map task is only seeing local information. So you cannot make any decisions which are requiring global information. So if you want to output only those terms that have a word count to be larger than 500, this decision can only be done at the reducer that knows the full global word count or the frequency count of this word, but cannot be done at the individual map processes. This is like an important observation. So some of the computations cannot be done locally, and here in this example, it's similar to what I just said. Some threshold crossing tests cannot be done locally because you don't have all the information necessary. However, the max aggregation from before, this works. And also summation would work. If you're computing the sum at the reducers, so the occurrences of a term at the reducers already, and then you're summing up the sums again at the reducer, this is fine, right? But it's not fine to do some tests on data which is not global. Also, if you're taking averages, it's also not possible. What you have to do then is to do the aggregation, that's fine. But then in addition, you have to send to the reducer the amount, the number of items the average is based on. And then the reducer can compute the average over these averages and not making a mistake. In general, you're getting problems if the function is not associative and commutative. Then this does not work. So, but this is like an easy or like a nice way, an obvious way you can limit the amount of information. And it's easy to recall what it does when you're going back to the example of word count, where we looked only at these 1 values. And this is also done in the Java code here, that you have 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, and so on output at the map side. And then it's clear that you can already, in many cases, pre-aggregate. But again, be careful that you're not applying something like this, like a test, that you cannot decide on the local information.